So let me remind you this conjecture, in case you don't know the statement. So we fix a field K, and we consider the capital V and G and K of so this is by what we calculated. We have geometric motifs. And I will always be with rational coefficients. We fix realization, so in the functor from K to the category of vector spaces over coefficient field F, which is characteristic zero. So this would be a classical realization function. So something like the Gram realization or Petty realization or Lebesgue realization, one of these functors. And then the convention said that this functor is conservative. And this means that you can use it to detect isomorphism between models. So I will not maybe comment about why this is an interesting conjecture, about the consequences of this. What I want to do today is, so I want to somehow speak about the following theorem, which says that this is true in case this is true for some models. In fact, this is and just a small warning that I'm still finishing the manuscript. So it's a bit. I'm taking some risk by setting this theorem, but I hope this is really toward the end, so I hope in less than 3 weeks this will be done. So I'm quite confident that this is working, and I want to talk about this. And so I will not try to make a resume of the proof. I will rather just pick one, focus on one aspect of this, one ingredient of the proof, which is important. And this is, I just speak about one ingredient, which is the construction of the new T-spectrum representing the Ramsdell function. And so this is a bit technical, but anyway, everything in this group is very technical, so I don't have, so it's one choice to speak about this. And but so I try to at least at the beginning, to somehow motivate things. So I want to start with a review of T spectra in multiple form.
Did you say anything more? Theorem? Or?
No, I will not say anything
about sorry? So you won't explain what the words in the theorem are?
I said it, so conservative.
I don't think Tom Roach is part of that, and I don't know what it means.
Okay, I mean, Tom Roach is. Do you know what this thing is?
No.
Oh, okay, so.
No, but even.
Tom Roach is. So this is. You take smooth projective varieties. Plus correspondences up to rational equivalence between them, and this forms a category. So concretely, it means that if you take a correspondence between two algebraic varieties, which induce an isomorphism in cohomology, then you can invert this correspondence algebraically. This is the meaning of the conjecture.
But this is the usual term. So this part does not depend on Neumann.
done, it would be very nice to listen to this construction.
Okay.
So we can talk later. Okay.
Right, so yeah, I want to start with a review of T will be I'll be working on complexes of precious on smooth varieties. Well, if you're not familiar with this, let me just give you a few examples that you can keep in mind. An example of such an object is all stars and invertible function on varieties. You can take also H3, the round of X. This is another example of a precious smooth varieties and so on. So these are just some kinds of functions, which are from varieties to complexes of abelian groups. And the T spectra is an example of such an object, and this is the free Fritsch sheaf. This is a free sheaf of vector spaces. So this is a free Fritsch sheaf of the vector spaces on GN, pointed by one. So this is very kind of stupid text. Just so it's if you evaluate T on X, this is the free vector space with basis of X, where we declare that that one is equal. All right, so. And what are these spectra? These spectra or these spectrum is by definition a collection E(n) of complexes of free sheaves on smooth varieties. So each E(n) is such a complex plus a max space from T. So the n to the n. So the idea is that T is some kind of a circle, and this is the analogous condition, the analogous definition of S1 spectra in algebraic topology. So this is what is S spectra. It's not this. Free in the sense that it's free generated by a set.
What's the GM
from 1? Sorry? So GM I think about GM as a free sheaf of sets which takes X to O star X. Mm-hmm. And it's a pointed free sheaf. So I point by 1, which means that I want to declare that 1 is 0 when I take the free thing. Yeah.
So it's the same as O star?
Huh? It's not the same as O star. So it has a map to O star. But it's not injective. You say that you can take the function x. So, example, if you take 3 times x minus 1, so let's take x to be spec of k x minus 1. So then you would have something like this. This is an element of this section of the species, but it's different from x minus 3. Okay, so it's a
okay.
Actually, it's not so bad to think about TSGN. If you prefer to work with it was OSTAR, it's also fine. You can just think about TS. It doesn't really matter much. Okay, so I want to give the examples of such objects. So there are the somehow three examples. Again, so here we start with this F, a complex of three sheaves on two varieties. And we build out of F, we build a T spectra simply by, so this is called the suspension spectrum. And this is written by the collection of these guys. And you take identity as maps between. So example, if you take the constant three sheaf with value q, so this would be the unit spectrum. So this is like the sphere spectrum, if you want. So these are the examples. Another example is motilic cohomology. This is somehow why this is. This object somehow appears in this context. So motilic cohomology is also an example of a spectrum. So you know that are for every integer there are so-called motilic complexes. I will not define them. Motilic complexes. One for every integer, so there are different constructions. And so this is a complex of three sheaves on smooth varieties, of course. And there are maps like this, which takes level n shifted by n to n plus 1, n plus 1. So why do we have such maps? Because if you think about this as graded complex. And this is a graded algebra, and so there is a map from T, as we have remarked, there is a map to O star, but O star is just essentially Q1 up to torsion. Right, so you can go from T to Q1 and then use a coproduct in motilic cohomology to build this map. Another example which will be important for us is Durand cohomology. So again, there is a T spectrum which is related to the Durand cohomology, and it's given. So I denote this. I denote it by omega underline, and it's given by a collection of complexes which are also denoted by omega with a k like this, and are shifted by n. And this guy here is simply the usual Durand complex. Right, so you know that the Durand complex is. Usually considered as a complex on a fixed variety, but you can of course take the global section and then let the variety varies, and this gives you a complex of three sheaves on smooth varieties. And this is what it is here. And it's the same construction. You have a map from T to H1 Durand, so this gives you a map that's here, and has a map from T to the Durand complex shifted by one. This is just a D logarithm. Mm. And then you use the top product of forms to build the complex. And so these are examples of this spectrum. So why do we care about spectra? The answer is very simple.
So here's the question. The answer is that T-spectra gives rise to, and more precisely to objects of GMK. So here you mark that there is no GM anymore. This is Vygotsky's big category of models. And how does this work? So the construction is three steps. So you start with let's fix E spectrum. So we do three things on this to obtain a motif. First, you make you replace each EN by an injective resolution. And this is, say, for the data topology. Then you make EN make EN A1 invariant. And this is using Susskind by Vygotsky construction. So if you want, I can say what it is, but the last step is you make E an omega spectrum. It has nothing to do with the omega object there. Omega spectrum means that the map from, so let me explain what this means here. This means that the map from EN to the space of loops from, so space of loops inside EN plus 1 is an equivalent. And this is a familiar condition, since these are called omega spectra. And there is a procedure to make any spectrum an omega spectrum. And when you do this, then you get essentially a motif. You can take this as a definition if you want. Okay. So this is the reason why we care about spectra, because somehow they model motifs. Yes. So let me just say one concrete statement which somehow explains what I mean by this. So here's an example or an explanation. So if you run this this algorithm on, for example, the unit spectra. So this is the thing that I used before. Which is given by just the collection of key tensor n with identity as bounding maps. What do you get? You get a multiplicative model.
So the Petit Grandier is, so you get essentially, in each degree you would get multiple tangents. So in this sense that this procedure somehow gives you motives. And somehow motivated by this, maybe you can modify the motive X to be the outcome of this algorithm applied on suspension spectra on X. Third example is what happens if we take this thing that presented on cohomology. Then the outcome is the same. So this goes again to the same object. So this guy somehow is already a motive. There is no need to make it a motive. Alright, so so what I want to do today.
I'm sorry, do you yes. mean sigma t
who's speaking?
You have a t of x?
Yes? Sorry?
Instead of x, should you have t of x? Just
it should be the free Q sheave on X. Okay, so as you do for T, but we do it for X. Okay. Thank you. I mean, maybe just a last bit of terminology, make a definition. This has, so this is effectivity. Plays a very important role in the whole story. So effectivity. So a T spectrum is called effective if it is of the form, if it comes from something like this. Infinity. Okay. So it's it comes in the sense that it comes by running this algorithm. On this right here. So these are called effective spectra. And just maybe going on. So try to make some linkage, maybe some something that you know. Yeah, I mean, I will not be very precise about this, so...
But you mean the motive part?
Yeah, I mean... Okay, so, yeah, so here's a remark. The thing that is represented on cohomology, omega, is highly non-effective. To make sense of this, it's not really so easy, but let me try to explain to a little bit why. So, so to be effective would mean that, for example, the map from level 0 to level 1 would be an isomorphism. So an effective spectrum would have something like T tensor, say E0 going to E1, it would be an equivalence, for example. Let's say an equivalence. Which means it becomes an isomorphism between models when you run this algorithm. So, what happens if we look at this map for omega? So this is a map. This the map from T tensor omega to omega by O, which is essentially a cup product with the D log. So we can ask ourselves, is this map an isomorphism? And in fact, it's so that is that's the question. Is this an iso
And the answer is very much no. How can we detect the failure of being of this map to be an algorithm? The reason is actually quite simple. If you look what this map is doing, so if you evaluate this map on a variety x and you look, it will give you a map from something to the Durand cohomology of x. And if you look at the image of this map, it's not difficult to show that the image will factor through the cohomology of poly evo bigger than one. So let me just write like this: the image of this map lies to coevo greater than, and this is coevo in the sense of Hodge 0. So this map is really, for example, if you evaluate this map on smooth projective varieties, it will be 0 in cohomology. Let me maybe make more precise my goal today. So I want to describe a T spectrum let's call it Z, which at the end will be, multiplicatively equivalent to the thing that represents the Durand cohomology. So it's at the end, it's not going to give me a new cohomology series. It's just it will be the Durand cohomology, but somehow. So this T spectrum, the feature of this, it helps understand better the failure of effective. And it's hard for me, at least now, to tell you how. So maybe at the end of the lecture, if you have followed the construction of this guy, I would be able to tell you in which sense it would help.
So there will be a filtration so that the successive graded pieces. Effective.
You mean the function of omega, or what?
Well, anyway, so you say.
Oh yeah, for any spectrum there is a so-called slice filtration.
Okay.
Causes somehow filtration where so degree zero would be effective, degree one would be effective after twist, and so on.
Yeah. And that relates to the Coevo filtration there.
Huh? That's what was the Coevo.
Thanks.
What's the equivalence relation on this?
Sorry?
What's the equivalence of T spectra?
So, good question. So I say that a map is an equivalence of T spectra if it induces a isomorphism on the associated motives. Let's call it like this. Okay? This Z that I construct will not be a motive in the previous sense. But when you look at this motive that it represents, then you will get omega. Okay? And somehow the idea that we'll have more freedom to work with Z than working with omega. This is what makes this is somehow what's important for the problem. So I want to explain the construction of this new spectrum. And fortunately, the construction is very messy. So I think this is maybe the first time I really try to describe this object in a lecture. And this morning when I tried to write this down, I was always saying it was a very bad idea to do this. So I don't know. Let's see what will happen.
Alright, so I first describe some tools. So you can now forget a little bit about what I said before. So I want to describe some tools which give us a way to define a new pre-sheaves on your spectra and so on. Okay, so these are kind of easy stuff, and hopefully you'll be able to follow this. First I want to speak about stratification. So in the usual sense. So X, let's say, a scheme, finite type scheme, we all know what is the stratification of X. So this is just, you write down X as a decomposition. This one is composition of strata, which are called strata. And so these are locally closed subschemes, and you want that the closure of a stratum is the union of stratum. It's the usual notion of stratification. There is a notion of, say, morphism of stratified schemes. So this is the obvious one. If you have any doubt, please ask me, I will tell you exactly. I will be also considering special cases. So X is smooth. We can speak about regular stratification. What is this? This is just something that is induced by a normal crossing divisor. Right, so you have a normal crossing divisor on your end, and the strata will be somehow. You take a bunch of divisors, you intersect them, and you remove the other divisors. This will be the strata. Okay, if you have any question again, just ask. All right, so let's give names to this. I'll be denoting by schemes sigma over k. This is the category of stratified. And then there is a subcategory which is denoted by smooth sigma k. This is subcategory of regularly stratified. Morphism of stratified schemes is just a morphism that when you take a stratum in the target, you take the image, inverse image, you get something which is constructible for this stratification. This is a morphism. It's the same as saying that every stratum should be mapped inside the stratum.
Yeah.
The stratum inside. So you see, if you have two, let's say for example, two regularly stratified schemes. There's usually very little morphism between them. I mean, there are already very little morphism between two schemes, but then it's also given an extra condition. But the funny thing is that there is the following easy remark or lemma. Maybe before saying this, let me just very quickly here take a definition. So one can speak about, so if you have any topology, so if you have a tau, a topology on, let's say, smooth varieties or schemes, you induce a topology on the subject. So I also call tau on the stratified version. So what does it mean? It means that if I have a family of morphisms between stratified schemes, that I declare that this is a covering if it is a covering after forgetting the stratifications. Okay? And again, state the following lemma. So there is an obvious inclusion like this. But it just considers the coarse stratification on a variety. And so this induces an equivalence of sides of topos for the eighth topology. Okay, so and the eighth topology is the topology which is generated by proper projected morphism and because of the Zariski topology. So it's really a very easy statement. I will not, unless you want to prove it, I will prove. But just a remark. So why this is interesting? This is interesting because this is interesting because of the following thing. So if you want to construct H on smooth varieties, then it is enough to specify one on the stratified schemes. And so it's kind of surprising. So I will describe. I'll give a construction which really somehow depends on the certification, and there's no way to do it without having a certification, and then this lemma somehow give you a way to get a pre-sheaf on this thing. But then of course you lose any, you don't know how to describe it there. You only know how to describe it.
In Morse theory, when you have specification, you have these conditions, Whitney's conditions A and B. Yeah, very strong conditions.
Here, everything is smooth, and it's a normal crossing divisor. It's the possible, the best.
Oh, this
best
is the smooth, possible. The smooth case.
I'm sorry, do you really have H topology on these things?
Yeah, you do have H topology. As I said, you define it like that. I mean, okay, to be honest, you have first to do it on schemes. Here you have a fiber product, and it's easier, right. But then you just look at the restriction, okay. And then you can show, as for scheme, you can show that it's an equivalence of top.
Okay.
You can cover everything here by things coming from. Is a topology which is generated by a proper surjective morphism and the Zariski topology. Alright, so the next thing I want to begin is the notion of tangential morphism between stratified schemes. So maybe here let me first make a remark to motivate
to motivate this. So I'm interested in the following object. So if I have x, let's say, regularly satisfied smooth scheme. So there is this x0, which is the union of the open strata. So if x is connected, it's just the open stratum. So I want to consider categories of module with connection with regular singularity infinity over x0, over the open stratum. So I want to, for something that will become clear later, I want to consider these objects, these categories. And you remark that if you have a morphism of stratified schemes in here, you don't always get a functor on these categories. You would get one if y0 maps to x0, then you can just pull back. But in general, you cannot pull back. But you can do something interesting. Is you can use the limit construction. But the limit construction will not give you functoriality for this map, it will give you functoriality for something which I call tangential morphism. So let me tell you what all these. So the idea is that one has better functoriality, one has better functoriality with tangential. Which I need to describe now. And to do this, I need a construction. So here's the construction. So take again x a stratified smooth scheme. And let's see inside x the stratum. And then you can look at the smallest constructible neighborhood of the neighborhood of C. So this is the smallest constructible neighborhood. And
we need the topology.
So there's a topology. So this is just the union of the strata which contains C with that topology. And then there's a natural lattice as to this. So this is the lattice of constructible graph K divisor in DXC. Okay, so just look at the divisor that contains C, the divisor that you use to define the specification. And then you can, so I define N0 XC to be the spectrum of the diode sum of V in this lattice.
You say you take the divisors of the maximal, almost next to maximal strata.
So you take the,
you just take all the divisors which contain C. That's what this
is. But these are the maximal strata.
That's what Rx C is.
Yeah.
Okay.
I know this.
Yeah, okay, no, I just was this.
But since I have
sorry?
Constructible
means that it's a union of spectrum of strata.
Okay.
So take the sum of the divisor, and you do the usual thing. I think this is fine. Okay. So I hope it's clear what I mean by this. Some kind of normal call, but it's an open normal call. All right. So, and on the other hand, you have the let's call n plus xc. This is the normal call of the closure of the strata. Okay, so we have two things like that. And so one is inside the other. N0 xc is inside n x plus c. And the complement is a normal crossing divisor. And you can think about the n plus xc as a stratified scheme. Okay. And so it's sometimes like you are, I don't know if this is the right term here, but it's you are zooming somehow.
So you're assuming normal crossings here or not?
Everywhere is normal crossing.
Everywhere is normal.
Okay, so in this category here, mm-hmm. every x is smooth, and the subtraction is obtained from the divisor with normal crossing.
C is one of the strata, one of the closed strata.
It's open. It's not a closed one.
Okay, C is open.
It's not open. It's not open. It's locally closed. It's a strata.
Locally closed. Then is this the same thing as blowing up C and removing all the proper transforms from the
divisors? Yeah, probably. It's a normal cone, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
But then you remove all the divisors.
Exactly.
You remove the lower dimensional thing, which...
You can go up and then you remove all the proper transforms. This is NZ. Okay, and then I can now define what is tangential. Again, it's always between smooth, let's say, regularly stratified. So it's given by a couple. So it goes from 1 to x. And so C would be a stratum. And f would be the map from y to n x plus c. So it's a stratified morphism plus the condition that takes y0 inside n x. Right? And for this kind of morphism, you get an induced. So what you do, so you have the limit function from x0 to this guy, and then you put that down. Alright, so this is this was second tool, and then flags. So now again I take x in this. So what is a flag? This makes sense in any stratified scheme. A flag is just it's a sequence of strata. So sequence such that D0 is inside D1 bar, and so the I is. So one can speak about maps between flags. Oh, it's actually rather an older relation. So we say that there is a map from D to C if this strata that makes C are in, so the set of strata that makes C is inside a set of strata elements. I hope this is clear. Okay, this is so we define an order set. We define an order on the set of plans, and I have seen the orders as a category. Okay, and so this gives rise to a category that I denote by dr fl of x. Okay, so for any x square that is this category, an ordered set of facts.
Finite domain is
flat. Yeah, everything has finite domain and some finite domain stuff. It's a finite order.
We assume that V0 is not equal to V1.
Yeah, there are strict. That's, yeah, I assume this also.
You assume.
Yeah, it's a strict. Yeah. We should assume. Maybe not very important, but I do assume this. All right, so here's a fact, interesting fact, is that if x is as before, you can define there is a functor from flag to, I did not get the name, but so I don't know if you just. This category. So what is this category? This is the category of stratified smooth schemes with tangential lines between them. Okay. And what does it do? It takes d and sends this to I denote by n plus xd. And by definition, so if d is this flat d0 up to dn, then this is by definition the n plus as before, but not in x, it's now in bn bar for the strata b0. This is the definition. It takes some work to make this into a functor, but it's true. Right, so why is this interesting? So maybe let me explain where we are going. So why I'm considering this. So what I will do, I want, let's say, gold, construct a pre-sheaf on smooth varieties. And as I explained, it's a little bit on stratified varieties. So what I will do, I will construct, so instead, a pre-sheaf flags in x with value in these categories, a regular singular and 0 x. And then you use some construction on regular singular modules regular singular. I think with everything like this, to cook up a complex of abelian groups at the end. But then this will be defined on flags. And then there's a way to go from flags to X itself by some kind of a resolution. So the so-called Goldman resolution. So here's a remark. Given let's say a pre-sheaf from flag X to some category here, you can construct that is so-called the Goldman complex, or just I call it the Goldman complex, and it's given
So if I call this f, so it will be given by the direct sum on all flags. If either there's a map, direct sum on all maps of flags, and so on. And so you can copy puppet and you declare that this is f fixed. Okay, so this is somehow the idea is that you work on flags, you construct something there, and then you build from this a complex for each x, and then you check that this is functorial for morphism of certified schemes, and then you get a complex of p-sheaves on this category, and then you get something which will be at the end equivalent to the complex on the okay, so let me say more about this construction. Any question about what I said? No?
So this M0 is the same thing as the N plus, except you write M0.
No, M0 is an open struct in N plus.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, that's what I meant.
No, but one has to keep track of the boundary also, because some of the tangential morphism somehow depends on the boundary. So now I can give you, I can start giving the construction of this complex, of this spectrum Z that I spoke about at the beginning. So, well, so I need to introduce some notation again. So I'll let's fix. A base S, if I assume it's going to be smooth, and I fix a finite set I, and I need a map. It will not be clear why I need this map, but let me say it. So I fix a map also from. So in case somebody asks a question, if they can refer to this. So a map from I to closed form 1x. I'll fix such a map. All right, so then I look at the, I use this notation.
Closed on
exact. Exactly. So this is my notation for Q1. To the color. Okay, so I call this E bar, and it has inside this has E I, which is essentially GM. So I, and I think about this as a stratified, again, stratified, as usual, in the obvious way. Alright. And also, I call P star, so it's a notation for the map. For S to S, and I think about this as P1, this is P2. Just a convenient notation. And when I speak about P star here, X star, this means the following, it means the diagonal in this. Okay, and then this is. Usually noted by Px, and I have a map to x that goes to. So these are some notations, and I would be working in the category of smooth, stratified schemes over star, which means that these guys will be endowed with stratification, that they will be smooth and the stratification will be regular when I. Okay, so what I will do, I will construct. So I have to construct.
It's
a
spectrum.
The QX
is an additional
datum. No. This is, you have a map here and you project to EI, the EI bar.
That's
fine. And this is, yeah?
You do it twice?
Sorry?
What
is the S?
There's
an
S,
and Y. So the diagram is this.
Yeah.
And I call the projection to the second factor in here. Right, so there's, I can project from E bar S to E bar, and I compose, and this is...
So without S means what?
No, this is an absolute thing, it's over K. And when I put an S, it's a relative thing, this is...
So S is over K?
Yeah, but this is...
So S is a K-scheme?
Yes.
Do we...
Yes.
Ah, we didn't know that.
So, okay. Yeah, everything is over K.
Ah, okay.
Okay, this is that. And you project.
So your omega could be zero here.
Omega? What is omega?
Your omega.
S can be equal to K indeed.
Yeah. So
but,
it could be zero. Yeah.
This is the differential over K.
Mm-hmm.
It could be zero, it could be, it's not injected, it's just any map.
Sure.
Okay, so what I'll do is construct a T spectrum. On this gadget, and then maybe at the end of the lecture, I'll tell you how we get it.
I don't want to interrupt the lecture, but as I understand,
I'm done with the time.
No, but go ahead, but maybe not.
Can I take 5 minutes?
Maybe I should just as a model.
So, here's what we do. So, first let's mark the following. On this guy here, so if I look at flags, there is a functor to. To these categories, but there is an called N and I, which is a free sheaf on this category with values in here, which means that for every flag you give yourself an object here, and with of course the restriction map. What does this guy? This is just a universal. I don't know how. Log algebra or log sheaf. I will not define it. So we have this thing, and we start with that, and we try somehow to get to x zero, and this is how we do this. So let's give ourselves E a flag in x one. Now, to a flag in x1, I can project to a flag into this guy here. So this will be flag in x1. This is a flag in x0. And this is the obvious thing. You take a stratum and you look straight to the stratum, you associate the image, or the stratum which contains the image, and this will be a flag here. All right, and from this, you get the following diagram of categories. Singular,
and 0, I will not put anything. That is the functor like this, which is the inverse image. It goes to make like a singular and 0 x1, something like b, and then you there's a push forward. So you start with your n here, and an I maybe, or n, and doing this you get something which I call y. And so you in this way you get the pre-sheaf on this thing here with values in module with connection, regular singular, over x0, over this thing. Okay? And then you take the cohomology of the thing. Then take the Dirac cohomology. Okay, and this essentially then you apply to this Godman resolution construction, and then you get exactly a complex of pre-sheaf on this thing. This is essentially what it is. This will be the level 0 of the spectrum Z.
The Dirac cohomology in the Dirac complex?
Yeah, the Dirac complex. Or you can just take the R gamma. I check what is R home if you want from the unit. So this will be the level 0, and then to get the level n of the spectrum, what you do, you tensor. You are here, and then you tensor this guy with O star of n x 1 0 O star to z n. And this will give you the level n spectrum. So the complex is level n. Okay, so this is essentially what it is. And then somehow the why this is interesting, it's interesting because one can show that this guy when you look at the motor architecture, you get just the complex one. Yeah, I think I stopped.
Some questions?
Yes.
So what is it that you can do with this complex that you couldn't do with Omega?
Right, so omega is let's see. So I can do something with this object. So if I look at the Dirac complex and then I take the effective spectrum on it, I have an argument which works in this context, and this argument uses weight and cohomology. And in fact, it's essentially this argument tells you that you can go from here to motivic cohomology. That in fact the unit splits. There is an argument using weight that gives you this split. This argument fails when you take the spectrum omega. Essentially, for maybe one important reason, is that so this has weight. Has a weight structure, but the weight zero part of it is still very big. It's not as here, it's not trivial. Here the weight zero of this complex is just the constant pre-sheaf Q, and then this gives you splitting. Here the weight zero part is still very big, and this has to do with the non-effectivity of this complex. Now with this complex, with this new gadget here, you see it's essentially something. It's very close to something like this. You see, in each level, in level n, you just have to introduce O star n to get, and otherwise it's the same.
And so the idea is somehow to run this argument with weight on that context. And then somehow to project to something smaller. It doesn't work as like this because, unfortunately, one loses. So this guy has no weight. It's here, there is no weight anymore. And the reason is very simple. It's because of this gadget here. So this is something which lives in the RAM cohomology. And it has, I mean, you can put a weight structure on it, but it has no canonical one. And at some point there is, you see that you are using, that's something I didn't tell. I didn't tell you how to go back to smooth varieties without the star. There is a procedure, and I didn't tell you how it depends on I. So there's this dependence on I, in fact, which is not here, but because of this dependence on I, this guy has no compatible weight structure in some sense. And somehow you lose the weight thing. You use the weight structure, but there is something that you can still do and make it.
Any other questions? Yes?
It's a bit early, but can you do similar things, or could one do similar things with the RAM bit complex and positive characteristic?
So I thought about doing something similar for religious homology. So I said, this is the same question. Many things somehow can be known, but there is one place in the argument which I don't know how to do this, which is unfortunately a bit far from what I was speaking here. So this has to do with the way one has to overcome the fact that there is no weight on this complex. So there will be some weight, but this will not be weight on cohomology, but this will be weight on relative cohomology. So something like a push-forward sheaf. So something like a variation of force structure that would appear here. And there is an argument which is, there's a construction due to Deligne, which give us some specific fiber functors on these categories, which behave well under inverse images. And I make use of this in a crucial way, and there is no, I think, as far as I know, there is no analog of this in this setting. So I think this is maybe the only place, at least, which seems that something missing. But maybe there is a way to overcome this.
Some other questions?
Sorry, yes, maybe I missed it. So you have some text on conservativity in the internet. You will finish some other text in 3 weeks.
No, it's the same text which will be finished in 3 weeks. This text is still in revision, and the revision will end in 3 weeks.
So what is the main result? What do you,
the main result is
what is the maximum you can hope for?
Sorry?
What are the current main results and what is the maximum you can hope for?
So the goal is to show the conservativity for Chow motives. This is up to now I cannot go further than Chow motives, but I think the main result is stronger than this. But the main result is more technical to state. So.
Okay. So I had a very short question. You talk on weights on this version of Omega. Do you have also a fit question on this version of Omega?
Fit question. You mean the Hodge
fit?
On the Omega.
On your version Z.
I mean, so there is a way to rewrite this P spectrum, so that there is a quasi-isomorphism with something, and this something has a mixed force structure, so has a weight coefficient and Hodge coefficient, but it's not. It's this quasi-isomorphism is not explicit.
Oh.
So it's not, you cannot see it on the level of this context.
And you cannot see it on the Z, you just...
you don't see it neither on the Z.
Okay. Okay, thank you. So, other questions? So, we wish you good luck, and us also if we have the conservative conjecture in 3 weeks.